is.
Yeah, just to be right, it's the council has made a huge error in how it's handled this particular case by naming the subject member, by not following its own protocol.
Yeah. Okay, I'll turn this.
By not following its own protocol, and we should, as elected members, forward all elected members.
Good. Sorry about that again.
We should afford all elected members some protection. The subject member, as well as procedural matters, has his name been put in the public domain already. Comments have been received. I think lessons should be learned, and then this case should be dismissed without any further action.
Could
we note that we didn't have a second of that, please?
Yes.
Because neither of the members wished a second. I think it's involved in the public domain.
No, I have no problem with all that happening, Councillor Lindley. When I've been in the minority, I've always been grateful that officers made no claim quite often. Panel considers, and I'm with this on the chair, panel considers that whilst the process was compromised by the publication of the name of the member, that this panel considers, having regard to the explanations offered, the panel should continue to consider the matter. Now, we're considering the matter, we haven't discussed the issue of the public yet, or not, but we have a vote on continuing to consider the matter first.
Would you like a seconder?
Yes, of
course. And I would second what you have moved. The consideration, the advice that we had on the consideration that I made was whether or not the person in question would get a fair hearing from this panel. And I have been convinced that we are all able to do that and fulfill that duty. And that's why it's a question to the
I agree with that sentiment, and it ought to be recorded in the matter of natural justice. I think we now need to move to considering whether the matter as such should be considered in the public or exempt session. Any members, any comments? So just clarify what Councillor
Moira. What would be the reason for moving the exception?
It's a matter for the committee to decide whether you consider the matter in a fully open hearing, whether you consider part of it in closed session, or whether you consider the whole of it in closed session. Obviously the report you've seen has not been redacted. It does contain information about all persons. I have been in contact with some of those persons who have expressed the view that they would not object or not wish their information to be redacted if we decided that they were going to hold the matter in public session. But obviously they would want their comments that they may have investigated to be made public as well. I think some of those are contained within Mr. Gilchrist's report. But obviously it's a matter for the panel to decide whether or not.
Contempt that's held in public. So, we on this occasion do not exclude the press and the public, and we continue the public session. That's my view. I think we now have to go into the consideration of standards complaint. Yes. Councillor Blakeley, are you able to contact?
I'm in testing.
Yep. We shall await the arrival of men and not conduct any business until our members arrive.
Can we have a copy of the draft? Generally, okay.
But we continue, but we hold the session in public. Passes the number. Passes on the. Can you bear with us a second? We're not stop.
decided by a vote of 4-1. Now they're going to get the
rules about explanations. I've heard the explanations.
Yeah, because I'm the judge of what she's doing is she wasn't quite sure what she'd said, so she's just
clarified.
You see, I'm
not sure what I'm
saying.
Good evening. Where would you like me to sit, Chair? Anyway,
wherever you feel comfortable, Councillor. I wanted to bring you up to date. The committee of you take your seat.
Yes.
The committee have considered a number of procedural matters raised by Councillor Blakeley.
Yes.
Give some thought to those, but as a result of our deliberations, we decided to continue with the matter that's before us.
Okay.
They have also decided that it should be heard in public. The report that has been prepared by the independent solicitor, Mr. Coacher, along with all its appendices, has been given to the member of the public.
Okay.
Mrs. Shaw was quite clear in advising that there had been a request that all the correspondence and matters raised in return to the, around the matter should be read. And we understood that, there were no objections to that. In fact, those members who were otherwise mentioned in it were quite content for their names to be and their comments to be included. And any comments they've made in response to the report were also included.
Yeah. And does that include correspondence from the complainant to the local authority as well as all
the complainants that to receive
So that will be mentioned in time.
Perhaps I should have said
that
the complainant won't be attending this evening.
Yes.
I've read this report and gone through it at a great deal of time and compiled a whole list of questions for complainants. And now it looks like I'm not going to be able to ask them.
The complainant indicated that she felt that this was now like an internal matter for the council and she was not going to attend the hearing this evening.
Well, it is an internal matter for the council, it's an internal matter for this panel. And this panel member has lots and lots of questions for the complainant. And now we've started that opportunity to get answers from the complainant direct, which disadvantages the subject member. And therefore, Chair, I will move that this panel is deferred until such time as a subject member, such time as a complainant can attend.
Think about that for a minute. Councillor McLaughlin, do you have any comments?
There are parts of the statement.
Advice. I have seen words whispered in my ear. For me, it's a matter of regret that the complainant has not made herself available in order to be asked for her views and to be questioned in detail. However, Ms. Shaw has some comments she wished to make. I think from some paperwork I read that whatever we do, we don't spend our time cross examining people. That's somewhere in the protocol. However,
Is that part of the protocol matters,
Mr. Chair? Those parts of the protocol, Councillor Blakeley, are considered carefully by me.
Building on my previous experience with these panel hearings, we have had the opportunity to question anybody who has provided a statement. I've only done two, but both of those included that as part of the process, and both of those occasions, information that came out of that questioning was relevant to the judgment that we had to make.
Whilst I consider the points that have been raised, as Councillor Blakeley, I haven't taken on board the comments you've been making. I know you feel some have been dismissed, but I'm weighing these up. I want to ask that Mr. Shaw will give you some advice here. The question was raised whether the member and the public were present about the issue of time scales. If we were to consider adjourning to a date at which we would like to reconvene and to which the complainant were to be invited, would the members here and the member complained about feeling disadvantaged by that extended timetable? That's what I'm now telling you. Perhaps if I might ask Councillor Hayes, if we were to adjourn based on seeking the attendance of the complainant, would you feel that if that meant that the matter lasted somewhat longer and went on until such time as she told us whether she was or wasn't available, would you be content with that taking place? Or
well, Chair, as I understand it, it's not been the case that simply the legal officer set a date and said we're here or not, we'll go ahead without you. I think the complaint has made an active decision not to be present this evening, and I would ask the panel to make whatever inference they deem necessary as a result of that absence. I too regret her absence. I do feel it puts me at a disadvantage, but it will put me at a further disadvantage and cause inconvenience for panel members, for the investigator, if it was delayed any longer. So I'm content for the matter to proceed.
Well, thank you for that. I think we should, as members, Mr. Sutcliffe, you're quite content, and Councillor Hayes is about to be recorded. Having heard what Councillor Hayes said, if Councillor Hayes had said, I'm not going to proceed until the complainant is present, or can we ask to attend and then consider what happens then?
Well, quite frankly, Chair, this has been a sword of Damocles over my head for some time now. I just want that to resolve. The complainant has chose actively not to attend this evening despite the complaint and what is in that complaint. So,
and I think that speaks volumes, that the complainant has actively chosen not to be here tonight.
I just think that's my problem.
Yeah, I'm thinking this with my mind.
Which is virtually agreeable, but you were just about to say.
Oh, very kind.
I've got a debate chair. I agree we have no power to drag it. But I care to speak. She's the one who's made this complaint. She's the one who brought this here. She's the one who's got the council to commission an investigation. She's the one that that's started this whole process. And then she sends you all to that. I think that is outrageous. I think it speaks volumes about that individual. And I am really disappointed that she's not here today, because there are lots of questions I have for her that I'm not going to get answers to. And I think that is outrageous. And I think, you know, not only if we're coming on without her, fine, but I think as a standards panel, we should write in the strongest possible terms to Professor Atkins to say how disappointed we are if she did not attend.
Just pondering on this for a bit. I think Mrs. Hudson's notes will show that Councillor Blakeley expressed strong dissatisfaction with the non-attendance of the complainant. I'll suggest the following wording. The panel places on record its considerable regret that the complainant chose not to attend this hearing, believing that questions could and should have been raised about the matter and the word manner and wording in which the complainant expressed her complaint. In the absence of the complainant, based on Councillor Hayes's desire that the matter should continue without further delay, the panel remains to continue this matter, but believes that a letter should be sent to the complainant expressing the panel's strong concern and dissatisfaction at her non-attendance. Does that cover anything? Sorry, I make this up on the top of my head about that Mrs. Hudsworth can decipher her writing in the end. I'm sorry, I'm going to take
the line.
I think we're all now. My recollection is, having chaired two other committees, that we want to ensure that we explore the investigator's report, that we give Councillor Hayes every opportunity to question the investigator on the report. There were a number of findings in the investigator's report where Mr. Gilchrist considered the complaints raised by Professor Atkinson against other members. It strikes me at this stage that if members accept that those particular matters are not being pursued, and that Mr. Gilchrist's report, having thoroughly investigated them, has recommended to us that those need not be pursued and should not be pursued, and we should concentrate our attention on the particular matter relating to Councillor Hayes. Is that?
I agree with that.
Thanks very much. Councillor Blake, you're
right. Yeah.
Thank you. Yes, thank you. Mrs. Shaw has reminded me. Perhaps if, because the document is not public, we'll just turn to, I think it's page 149 onwards, really. Mr. Goetsch will tell me if I'm on the right page or not.
There's a summary of the what I identified with the last page, page 133.
133, that's right. Are your pages the same or that?
Yes.
Yes, I believe so. I hope so.
Right. There is 133. I was really majoring in on page section 75 onwards as well. Now, I don't quite relate these two together, and that was really, really sorry about that.
Well, I don't know if you have me to maybe summarise.
Yes.
Because I obviously came in late, could I have an indication as to what the process is here?
Yes, I'm sorry. I just sort of candid through it in there.
Yes, I just don't like to know what I mean.
Right. I'm sure Ms. Shaw will suddenly kick me and remind me about what the process should be. I was asking at the start of the meeting if there was actually a working note about all the steps.
Yes.
But as I see it, Mr. Gilchrist is invited by the panel to present his findings, and we will give you every opportunity to question Mr. Gilchrist about those findings. The findings that we're considering are only those that Mr. Goshie believes should be presented to us and not other matters. I hope I've got that right. Ms. Shaw's going to tell me if I've got it wrong, please. Right, I'll do it well again. So, is that all right? Are you content with us doing that?
Definitely content, Chair, and obviously it's up to yourselves as to how you proceed, but I do have a short statement as well, and that's something I would like to read that, if that is in order, Chair.
Which one would you like to do it?
It's exactly to yourselves.
Normally, the investigation would present its report, and the Council has been given the opportunity to make its representations.
Mr. Gilchrist, your statement, would you like a copy so that we can study it and that it's put into the record, or is it something that you
can... Yes, it's certainly something we can provide the clerks with if they want to publish it.
And for us to read when we get there?
I don't have any other copies, unfortunately.
Would it be reasonable to adjourn for a few minutes to allow Councillor Hayes to get his statement copied so that we can consider it rather than just hear it? Is that a...
Would you like me to just email it to you with the advance?
But I think the members would like a copy now.
I've got notes on this
copy.
Right.
I'm content to hear what comes from.
Content to hear. Right. So we'll hear Mr. Cllr to clear all matters that are not being complained about. How are those to be dealt with in the record?
Well, they've not been referred to the panel.
Right. So only those matters that Mr. Cllr believes should be brought to our attention are being considered. Right. So Mr. Cllr, I'm sure you've been thinking about this.
Yes, and I appreciate that you obviously have the papers and you have the opportunity to read them, so I'll try and keep it brief and just focus on what I think the key issues are for you to
and you will tell us which page.
I will refer you to relevant pages.
If we just need to pause to make sure we found the page, that will be.
I will try and follow what you're doing.
If you draw it just to a page, it can give us time to find it.
I will endeavour to do so, but please do stop me if I'm rushing ahead.
Thank you very much.
But I will endeavour not to do so. So as you said, if you look at page 133, what I've done there is produce a summary, and I've set out the matters of complaint, as you quite rightly identified. There were a number of complaints, there was one complaint which referred to, but it was about three councillors, and there were a number of elements to it. I have concluded that none of the other councillors, the other two councillors identified, it failed to comply with the code in any way, and the reason for that set out in the report, but I believe the monitoring officer has accepted that, and therefore no further action should be taken. In respect of Councillor Hayes, there were three elements to the complaint against him, and I've listed those at I, and IV, paragraph 2, and then in the middle of the page. And I concluded, having investigated it, that in respect of the first two of those, that being those relating to his behaviour at the Overview and Scrutiny Committee meeting, that there was no failure on his part of the pilot code in terms of the conduct on that occasion. And as I understand it, the monitoring officer has accepted that conclusion and therefore not referred those matters to the panel, so they are concluded. And the position is that Councillor Hayes has not failed to comply with the code in respect of those two elements. The area, the aspect of the complaint which I concluded did amount to a failure to comply with the code on his part is set out in IV, paragraph 2, and that relates to the comments which he made in the media shortly after the I will take you through a little bit of the background that led to this complaint and the reasons for why I concluded that. Obviously, it's a matter for you whether you agree with those findings or not. So the background to the complaint, which I won't go into in any detail, is set out pages 136 to 138 of your pack, which is paragraphs 13 to 22 of my report. I will briefly talk about the background to it because I think it's very important, although it may well be that you are more familiar with some of the elements of the background than I am. But obviously you're aware that the complainant is the independent chair of the Wirral Safeguarding Children's Board, and the decision which she made, which ultimately gave rise to this complaint, complaint was not to publish a serious case review, which had been conducted about a case involving child sexual exploitation. And that case had resulted in two people for very serious sexual offences. The complainant decided not to publish the serious case review, and the reasons that she gave for that was that she felt it was not possible to do so without risking the identification of the young person involved. And she also said that she did so following the receipt of legal advice. She also highlighted to me, and it's in your packet, page 96, that this decision was... So she highlighted that this was a decision which was referred to the National Panel of Independent Experts on Serious Case Reviews, which is a national body, as the name suggests. And the letter which they sent in response to her is there, and what it says is, really, I'll highlight it, the panel considered carefully the information provided by the letter on the 14th of August, given the particular circumstances you identify for concern and the impact the publication may have, together with the advice you received, the panel accepted your decision not to publish. I think it's fair to say that Councillor Hayes and a number of others were unhappy about that decision, and he raised it to the Children's Services Member Task Force, which you will be aware of, Mr. Chair, if you're a member of that, is a cross-party group which meets in private to discuss issues around the improvement of children's services provided to children within the borough. And the serious case review was discussed at the task force meeting in September 2017. And at that meeting, Councillor Hayes expressed his concerns. The complainant was present at that meeting, and after the meeting, she wrote to Councillor Hayes on the 3rd of October 2017, setting out her decision. And that's in the letter of pages 92 to 95 in your pack, at which the letter from the National Panel was appended to that letter, page 96. I'm not going to read that out, it's merely referred to highlight the fact that she had set out very fully in response to Councillor Hayes' comments at that meeting the reasons for the decision that was made, and highlighted the fact that the National Panel had accepted that decision for the reasons that she had given.
Reassure all members have read that letter, and I've scribbled notes all over it, but I think we have that before us.
Thank you.
Did you see all the two chairs who could ask me? What's happened to the questions?
There are points that I had underlined, and her presence, as we've already indicated, might have allowed us to pursue.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Following that letter, there was a meeting of the Council's Children and Families Overview Treatment Committee on the 14th of November 2017, which has been mentioned, and the complainant attended that meeting to present their annual report. Another member of the Overview Screening Committee asked the complainant about the report and expressed the review that that report should be made available to the Overview Screening Committee. That was one subject of the rest of the complaint, which I didn't feel was a failure of that member to comply with the code. Following on from that interaction in the meeting, Councillor Hayes then very briefly spoke and expressed his disagreement with the decision record. Again, those comments were subject of another element of the complaint, but in my view, that complaint was not upheld. Councillor Hayes, in expressing the views at that meeting, did not, in my view, fail to comply with the code. And it's important to note that I've not found any failure on the part of Councillor Hayes to comply with the code arising from his behaviour at either the Overview Scrutiny Committee meeting or the earlier task force meeting, or in terms of his interaction with the complainant in between those two meetings. The sole issue which led me to conclude that there had been a failure to comply with the code on the part of Councillor Hayes was the press release which he issued shortly after the Overview Screening Committee and the reporting of that. And I'll refer you to page 79 which is the note of the interview which took place between myself and Councillor Hayes.
Just give us a moment to get this. This is the one dated the 20th of February and signed on the 9th of April.
Yep.
This is 1.67891 interview notes which are all pages 20th of February.
Yep. So page 79, which is the second page of that note, and paragraph 16 refers to the press release. He confirmed that he issued a press release which said that the decision to keep this report under that's local, I should say, lock and key will undoubtedly lead to accusations of the cover-up. He then went on to state that this had already been suggested by the complainant herself at the task force meeting. And he repeated that he believed that justice needs to be seen to be done and that the council's reputation and the reputation of those who work in child protection is damaged by the fact that the report has not been published. So that press release was issued, and Councillor Hayes accepts that that was the wording that was used. And this was then quoted in press coverage following the release, the release of that press release, and I included some of that press coverage in the documents included to my report, and I refer you to page 117 and 180, which is a report published in the Wirral Globe.
I've got those pages of members' comments.
Yes, thank
you. Loyal pages. Sorry, it's 117 and 118, Councillor Blakeley. Just wait till everyone's got there. Yep. Please proceed.
So, page 179, I highlight the headline, which the Wirral Globe has published. Cover up claim as inquiry into Jeffrey Wilde Charles expectations can have kept hidden from the public. So, that was the headline that the Wirral Globe published. And then, over page 118, sort of the third of the way down the page, the quote there from the press release from Councillor Hayes is included. The decision to keep this report under lock and key will undoubtedly lead to accusations of a cover-up.
Do you mind if I just ask something at this point? The word press release is used. I'll ask Councillor Hayes for advice logically, because press release means to me, I guess hold of somebody and send them something specific which they can refer to, either by email or whatever, or in paper form, and it's actually a release. I would clear that it was a release rather than perhaps comments made down by telephone or whatever, similar form, which when common members meet the press, they may just have casual conversations, so I need to clarify quite what it was. I hope it's in order, but can Councillor Hayes perhaps help us know when it was for the press release, or was it a conversation which went in a particular way, was recorded in a particular way?
Yeah, obviously I'm happy to know that it was a press release as you just described it. I'm happy you asked me this question because I wasn't probed at all in the simple sense as you just probed me around the press release and whether or not I felt it was justified by investigator. There was one paragraph in his questioning relating to this press release that the remainder of it seemed to be around the circumstances of the committee meeting, which is why I have gone into this process presuming that the complaint was centred upon my behaviour at that committee meeting, and in my statement you'll hear that I don't think I've had an opportunity to address the issue of the press release, the statements to the press. Hopefully I'll be able to satisfy the panel with some comments on that.
So, thank you. Councillors, yes. McLaughlin, Moira first, sorry.
Thank you. Actually, I'm looking not just at the first bit where you say the decision to keep this under lock and key will undoubtedly lead to accusation of the government. And then, Mr. McPherson, we would be asking questions when you have a chance to give us a version. But the entirety from, I'm appalled by this decision.
Sorry, what page are you on?
Sorry, page 18, where the inverted commas start with, I'm appalled by this decision. We owe to the victims of this tragic case to ensure those who failed on the part of how could this possibly happen? So you are actually criticising the decision to withhold the, not to publish the full report.
Absolutely. I don't demur from that
in any shape or form. It's my criticism, that remains my criticism. I don't have the press release in front of me. I would have provided it to the investigation.
Have we have it, it's okay. It's in your panel there.
Is it?
On page 8.
It's not
the press release.
No,
it's
the
press
release. Yeah.
The Globe article is.
But the press release isn't there. Yeah. And I would have happily provided that had the investigation asked me.
To 2 points, talking about that. Just to go to you, talk about the headline, Wirral Birth. Have you seen the press release? Have you got a copy of the press release?
No, I haven't.
Did you expect that headlines aren't written by the press release, that sub-editors write the headlines?
I do,
I do have a copy of the press release. I'm not going to share it with anybody because you've made assumptions. I can tell you that was not what was on the press release. None of that was on the press release. In that format.
I've had to address
I started that exploration, but I think
you're I think to take the stage early, you started by saying comments he made in the media. I mean, what you should have said is you mean the comments you read in the media.
Councillor Hayes has accepted, and it's in the note that he signed, that he made those comments and that he made them in the press release. The issue that gives rise, in my opinion, to a failure on his part to comply with the code is what he said, not the format within which he said it. If it had been a quote in an off-the-cuff interview with a journalist, my opinion would have been exactly the same. The issue is not the format within which he made the comment, it is the comment that he made.
We've noted that.
There's lots of comments in that press release. Which comments are you saying the breach?
The one that I just read out to you, the one that I highlighted in my report. The locking key weren't actually being activated.
If you address remarks for me, please, we're not doing.
Sorry, Chair, I just want to put a lead to accusation.
Right.
An accusation hasn't been made. What Councillor Hayes is saying, this could lead to accusations being made. There is a real difference there.
Right. Councillor, you've made that point. I shall scribble it down to make sure it's like we can come back to it later. Mr. Gosher, I invite you to continue. I started that train of questioning, but I wanted to clarify something, sir.
Yes, I'm happy to have you say that, although obviously in some senses it may be helpful to clarify things when you've heard the details of what I've said rather than preempting things that are going to address later in the presentation.
Can I just say that I have my hearing aid, but if you speak quickly because of the technology, such as these words tend to run together, so if you could just proceed slightly more slowly and not let words run in, I'd be most grateful. Thank you very much.
So it is this comment, the one that I've highlighted to you, the one that I've highlighted in my report, that I say, in my opinion, amounts to a failure to comply with the code, and I will explain that, and I have explained that reason in my report, I'll explain that to you again, and happy to answer any questions in relation to that. Just in terms of the point that the Councillor Hayes has made, which I also going to address now, but I think I should do, given that he's made the point. And it is made in the comments which he made on the draft report and the responses that I've provided to them. It was clear, in my opinion, in the letter from the complainant that she was complaining about the media coverage following the abuse group committee meeting. That's specifically referred to. I specifically asked Councillor Hayes in our interview about that, hence why that paragraph, which I've just referred to you, was in the note that he signed. He's also had the opportunity to explain, both in the interview, I expressly always give members the opportunity to say, this is your opportunity to respond to anything in the complaint that you want to, and also to provide you with any further information. So he's had that opportunity. I never restrict or limit members in terms of what they can tell me or feel they should tell me in an interview. It is their opportunity to respond to the complaint to me. He's also had a further opportunity in terms of commenting on the draft report. Now, obviously, I've included in detail the comments that he's made. has had plenty of opportunity to provide a justification for that comment that he made, both in the interview and in comments on the draft report. And as we go through, I'll explain that part of the reason for the conclusion that I reach is that, particularly on the basis of the information which he was provided with by the complainant in her letter and the national panel acceptance of those reasons, he has not provided any, and certainly I have not seen any evidence to support any accusations of cover-up. So I do take the point that, Councillor Blakeley has made, and I will address that in terms of the particular formulation of words that Councillor Hayes used, which is clearly irrelevant, and I will explain to you why I still nevertheless think that there's a failure to comply with the code in the wording that he's used. That's always a good sign.
We're always doing it.
I'm sure you do. So, first of all, I'm going to address, before I address the reasoning, the aspect that Councillor Hayes raised in the interview with him, and I subsequently explored with members who were and officers who were at the Member Task Force meeting in September, was that this very suggestion that accusations of the cover-up will be made came from the complainant herself at that meeting. So when that suggestion was made by Councillor Hayes, I then contacted everybody who was on the attendance list as having attended that meeting, and I've included a table appended to my report which sets out the people that I contacted and the responses that I received, and that's at page 127.
Let's all just change, right? All got it?
Yes.
Yep, please proceed. Yeah. Thank you.
So, you'll see from that effectively Councillor Hayes and Councillor Lewis stated that they recalled the form of words that Councillor Hayes had suggested